American University in Bulgaria.
Thank you for coming to the Political Science Club's event. This is one of the main events for this year. As a Political Science Club, we always strive to present all the point views on matters of importance. So far, the university has presented speakers who spoke very well about the European Union. Well, always not so well, as we have seen in the past 7 weeks, especially with Cyprus. This is why we invited the oldest think tank, independent think tank in Bulgaria, the Institute for Market Economics, to present their view on the developments in Europe, and more specifically on the costs of European Union membership, none of which are as clear as the direct payment which every country pays. Without any further ado, I will present to you Yavor Alexiev and Petr Ganev. They will speak to you. And after the lecture, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask them. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Vasco for the invitation. It's a real privilege and honor for us to be here. And I hope that what we come up with is interesting for you. Peter is the senior economist in the Institute for Market Economics. He's worked there for 7 years now, I believe.
Something like this.
Yes, something like 7 years. And Vasco was actually an intern at our think tank last year, somewhere around this time. And currently we have another intern from the American University, Jana Mushkova. I don't know if any of you know her. She's in her second year here, I believe. So what we've come to realize is that people from your university actually, although not as you could say economically centered overall, as far as people who have been to us, are people with broad perspectives, open minds, and are ready to challenge what they've learned and what they see and what others tell them. So that's why we're going to bring you some sort of perspective on EU and EU membership that maybe some of you have heard about, maybe some of you are not that familiar with, and we'll be really glad to hear in the Q&A section afterwards to hear all of your questions and try to answer them as best as we can. So Peter is going to be the one who's going to make the bigger part of the presentation. I'm going to jump in from time to time. And Peter.
Okay, thank you. First of all, thanks for the invitation, and I just want you to know that I see this as a free talk about, let's say, Europe. So if you have any comments, any questions, even now, you're perfectly free to ask or to jump in. We never like the idea of just presenting a view and then disappearing, which happened a lot at such kind of events. We changed a little bit the title. It's not just the cost of the EU membership. We put the economic growth perspective. Because this is not a cost-benefit analysis, like a balance sheet or something. It's not that the money that we give to the EU and then the EU funds that we receive, we just put the account and we see, is it positive, is it negative. It's far more complicated than that. Our goal, not only within the EU, but in general, is to prosper, which means in economic terms to have economic growth. So when you enter the European Union or a new set of institutions, to put it more generally, what you want to achieve is that you to grow, to prosper, to have more jobs, and to have less poor people. So this is our perspective, the economic perspective. It's not the cultural perspective. It's not the historian perspective or the peace perspective. They are interconnected, but this is the economic perspective. We decided to start with this because you probably know that yesterday Margaret Thatcher passed away. She, of course, was highly critical to the EU project. She was not critical to Europe. She was not critical that people can move freely or trade freely or invest in other countries. She was critical to the coordination of policies, to the single currencies, to powers transferred from national parliaments to Europe. This is her last speech after she was after she fallen as a prime minister in 1990. A few days after the decision was made, she went to the House of Commons to present, I think that the actual vote of the of confidence was at that date, but it was already known that she will fall. And she gave a great speech. It was a debate. You can see it on YouTube. She was in her strengths. And this is something that we put out of the of the stenogram, of the memo. And you see the one that I put in bold. That kind of Europe with a central bank is no democracy. Taking powers away from every single parliament and having a single currency, a monetary policy and interest rates which take all political powers away from us. You can say that this is too strong, but it's back in 1990. The euro was not even alive then, and still you can see that it's actually true if you look at it from today's perspective. Actually, the euro, the decision of the European Central Bank, the interest rates that were low for all the members of the eurozone actually played bigger role for the boom and then for the bust of European countries than the decision that their parliament actually, the reforms that they were doing and their national debates. Moreover, she said, a single currency is about the politics of Europe. It is about a federal Europe by the back door. This is also true, I think. You can challenge the motives or the argumentation on everything, but as a statement, this is true. The euro is not an economic solution. It's a political decision with economic outcomes. And we should always bear that in mind, because this is what shapes the usually the debate in Europe. What were the myths before the crisis? These were not things that were general truths. There are many people who challenged those myths, but still, those were the thoughts that were dominating the debate in Europe and in different countries. First, that the EU membership inevitably will lead to cohesion or less disparities in Europe. Or to say it in other words, if you're a part of the European project, you will prosper, you will catch up with the wealthier countries, and you all live in peace and less poverty and prosperous world. If you look at the data, not even after the crisis, even before the crisis, you can see that this actually didn't happen. Southern Europe is in far worse shape if you compare it to Northern Europe. If you see the dynamics of some of the countries, it's also a different story. There are countries who prosper, like Germany, for instance, and there are countries that have problems even in the boom times, which is Italy, for instance. So there was no guarantees with your EU membership. Also, there was the myth that EU membership will surely make you more competitive, which means that if you're part of the EU project, you have the single market, you have the right policies put together probably in Brussels, but not only, and you became more competitive in the world market. Well, this also happened to not be true. Some countries became competitive, but some other countries actually averse this proposition. They actually became less competitive. Also, the single currency was presumably working perfectly well. It was presumed that there are rules and proper institution in place. So maybe it was a political project, but we did it the right way. We have the institutions, we have the rules for the deficit, for the debt, for inflation. So everything is fine and we can only prosper. Well, you can easily see from the events that this did not happen. And last one, that prosperity will only emerge if we continue further the EU project, which means not just the single market, not just the single currency, but more Europe in general, meaning more of most of the decisions that are about to happen or about to take place to be shaped somewhere in Europe, to go to the federal project or something like this. The dominant statement was this, that even if the single market is working or the single currency is working, we cannot stop there. It's like ever-growing cooperation. So the only path is to lead to more Europe. This was, I think, the general thinking before the crisis, when there were the boom years and everything seems to be fine. Going back to Bulgaria, I want to mix them, the EU perspective and the Bulgarian perspective. How did our decision to become member of the EU take place? I think that it was inevitable, and it was the right thing to do. There was no other option. If you've been where we've been, with communism, with losing the first 7 or 8 years of transition, with hyperinflation, with banking collapses, then with IMF and with tough structural reforms, it was the normal thing to go to the West, to go after the EU. And I think that this was a success story, to become a member of the EU. There was no alternative in my point of view. Also, the EU membership was and is still dominated by the idea of the single market. This means free movement of people, free trade, and investments or free movement of capital. If you ask the Bulgarians why they support the EU before the before we joined or after we joined, most probably the argument will be something like this: because I'm free to travel, there is no border with Romania now, there is no border with Greece, I'm free to go to work to other places. Well, you are not free to go to UK, there will be some problems, and to some other places, but hopefully from the next year there will be no such restrictions. And we can also prosper from investments coming to our country. This is the leading argument. Nobody will say you as the first answer that he's waiting for money from the EU structural funds. Probably some businessmen in agriculture can answer that. But the average Joe in 2006 or in 2013 will say that he likes the freedoms of Europe or the single market. Also, what happened is that Bulgaria found itself to be the poorest member in a club dominated by rich countries. And this is important, because when you have such kind of club, it's a club of decision being made for all. So we all gather, we discuss, and at one point we take a decision that is most probably one size fits all decision. We should all follow the same path. But it's different if you are one of the richest and more competitive countries in the world, and if you are actually the poorest member of the club. This can have multiple challenges to you. For instance, if the richest countries in the world decide that they don't have problems with poverty, they don't have problems with electricity bills, so let's invest in green energy, why not? We want to be greener. We have the money to pay for that, why not do it? Well, it's logical for them, but when you put the same rules to the poorest member, which actually has problems with electricity bills, then you have problem. Maybe it's the right thing to do, maybe it's the wrong thing to do, but still, when you have the same decision for the rich and for the poor, it's usually a problem for the poor. Especially when the decision is shaped by the rich. We cannot tell Germany what to do, but Germany can tell us, or can moderate the decision that will be taken. What were the lessons from the crisis, which go back to the myths of the first slide? First, that the EU project failed to secure competitiveness and cohesion. Moreover, EU funds and the euro actually eased the pressure for structural reforms. Again, this is not like a hate speech of the EU or something like this. I just said that there is a myth that somehow if you join, you'll be secure to prosper. And of course, in theory, this cannot work. And the practice showed that it won't work. There is nothing secured within the your project. They can promise you everything, but your prosperity is not secured. You can easily fail. So, and moreover, when your development in the long term starts to focus not on competitiveness, but on how to absorb more euro money, like we are doing in Bulgaria now, we want to absorb more money. So the people in Ministry of Economy are working to absorb more money. They are not working to ease the business environment. I can assure you that because we met with them several times. And the only thing that they are thinking, they have a job, which is to absorb more money that they can absorb, to push it to the limits. And they have no time to actually focus on business environment in Bulgaria. The focus is different. And also for the members of the Eurozone, when you have, cheap money, and when the markets trust you because you are part of the Eurozone, you can easily finance your deficits or your debt, then you don't have the pressure to make structural reforms. If I am secure to have lunch tomorrow in American university, why bother to work tonight? I mean, I'm secure that my lunch will be free, probably paid by some other generation. Also, the crisis showed that EU is not prepared for failures. And this can easily be seen. The institutional framework is fragile, like modern banking, for instance. And it needs everybody to be successful. It doesn't tolerate any failures, like in banks. You don't want any bank to fail because this can ruin the whole system. The same is within the EU. You don't want anyone to fail, even if it's some small islands with Russian investments or something. You wanted everybody to be successful because the system is fragile. You cannot let any failures, which is a problem. In the long term, this is a problem. And also the EU project in its current state is actually built upon fiscal transfers. This could be, we see it with the fiscal transfers to save Greece or to save Cyprus, which is a pure transfer. The parliament in Germany votes and the money goes from the German taxpayer to the Greek people. This is visible, but before the crisis, it was through the euro. You have the competitive Germany, which is actually giving all the confidence to the markets, giving the strength to the euro, and it's all those southern countries that are actually taking advantage of this. So again, this is a fiscal transfer, but it is hidden within the currency. This is not problematic by itself. Like, for instance, in Bulgaria, we have fiscal transfers between Sofia and Blagoevgrad. Blagoevgrad is one of the developed regions, but still there are fiscal transfers from Sofia taxpayers to Blagoevgrad, pensioners, for instance. There are even bigger transfers to the northern Bulgaria when people are poor. When you are part of the society and you are all the same taxpayer, Bulgarian taxpayer, it actually makes sense to have fiscal transfers within this society. This is how all societies are actually working. The problem here is that there is no such thing as European taxpayer. Nobody sees himself as a citizen of Europe. If you ask somebody where you come from, he will say Italy, Germany, Bulgaria. Nobody will give you the first answer, I'm from Europe. There is no such thing. Not only culture, not only language, but Bulgarians are actually citizens of Bulgaria. And secondly, Europeans. So it's problematic because you have taxpayers in Germany, voters in Germany, which are involved in fiscal transfers with other countries, and you see all the tension between when you have such situation, the people in Cyprus trying to take money out of the ATM machines and screaming and Merkel and stuff like this. This is why it happened. It won't happen in Bulgaria with people from Blagoevgrad being angry at people from Sofia because we are the same society. But within Europe, this is a huge problem. What was the Bulgarian case prior to the crisis and after that? Especially prior to the crisis. First, we had no option for cheap gold. We, as I said, we had the banking crisis, we had the hyperinflation, we have the currency board. So what we have is actually that we cannot ease monetary policy, even if the ECB is printing money. This doesn't help us. We cannot ease monetary policy. And also we cannot ease fiscal policy because nobody will trust us to give us the loans, especially the first years of the new millennium. So in other words, the only way to grow or to move forward to the so-called catching up process was through competitiveness. If we want to become more rich or to catch up EU, Europe, we needed to be more competitive to work and to work for it. So we had this set of institutions that we couldn't cheat the gold, if you can put it that way. Still, our gold in 2007 and 2008 was in a way artificially inflated. It was during the time of the so-called late boom, as our gold was dependent on foreign investments. When you have such boom as in Europe, when you have so much money in the system, sooner or later they found their way to Bulgaria through banks, through easy credits to investments in Bulgaria, which are probably not that profitable. But even with the institutions, with the currency board, and with the fiscal surpluses at the time, still we managed to artificially inflate our gold from outside, which is money that we probably don't deserve because we are not competitive enough, came here because of the inflated gold of Europe. When the bubble burst, the crisis came, we had a huge hit on the labor market. This was the toughest hit. 4 years our employment is going down, so people are losing job. All these inflated investments in construction or stuff like this that were giving work to the low-skilled workers, which you have a lot, are now gone, and those people cannot find work. So we have also growing poverty in this 4 years because of the labor market. And now our gold is actually facing structural reforms, structural challenges. The correction already happened. It's not like Greece, when there is still correction to be made, so that their inflated competitiveness goes away and shows the real picture. What we have now in Bulgaria is the real picture. All the jobs that are created, they are not inflated. They represent the competitiveness that we have. If somebody is employed today, probably he is employed because of the fundamental factors that this is the job that we can create, this is the entrepreneurs that we have and everything. So there is no correction coming to Bulgaria. What we need to do now is to go even further, which means that we need structural policies in education, so people can have more skills and more ideas if they want to become entrepreneurs. We need more flexible labor market, so it's easier to create jobs. And of course, we have the demographic challenges, which pose a threat to our social policies like healthcare and pension. But so it's a different challenge. It's not a fiscal challenge of how to not go bankrupt, which is the challenge in Greece. It is a challenge of how to grow. There was a few graphs here. You see what we compare is Bulgaria to the other southern countries. As I said, there was a difference within Europe. It's not the same object with the same characteristics. If we put ourselves in the same picture as southern Europe, you can make an interesting picture. You see, for instance, that most of the public spending is going up in the last 10 or 11 years. The big bump is the Ireland bailout of the banks. So you see, when the state is by definition staying behind of its banks, it's a debt that you actually hold, but you don't know you hold it. You see when you bail out the banks what happens. But still, Bulgaria is the country with lowest public spending. It's because of the currency board. It's because of the lack of capacity to actually borrow money. You see how our debt moves. This is the EU, the 27 countries' debt. The rule was 60% for the Eurozone. You see how close to the crisis, 2007-2008, it's around 60%, a little bit more, and then it grew substantially in the last few years. And you see the Bulgarian debt, which is actually going down. So when the rich countries were borrowing money, what we did, we actually pay our debts out. And we succeeded to grow in a way. What's actually shown, also shown in this graph, is that there is no such thing as sustainable level of debt. You can think that 60% is sustainable, but it was not that sustainable in 2008. So it's sustainable until the point it becomes unsustainable. That's the general definition of sustainable debt. Romania showed us that they can go bankrupt with less than 20% debt, less than our debt actually, it was like 15%. And they needed IMF, they cut their wages by 20%, stuff like this. Some of the Baltic countries also show us that your debt can grow from 20 to 40, 60% in just 1 or 2 years. So sustainability of debt is not about numbers. It's about structure of the economy. It's about the fundamentals. It's about the ability to grow. So you see, we have a completely different picture from Europe, especially from Southern Europe. Again, with this southern countries and Ireland, as it also is like one of the bailout states, you see the change in government debt for these 11 years. In every country, it's growing. You can see what's happening in Greece. It's like 60, 70 percentage points. It's also actually the same size as the economy. Also in Ireland because of the bailout.
I think it's twice as that.
Yeah. Probably twice as that. And you see Bulgaria, which is the totally in the other direction. And you can say, okay, well, you have these countries which are supported by the euro, which are taking debt, which are the best receivers of EU funds, actually Portugal, France, Spain, Greece, Italy. These are the countries that receive the most from the EU funds, from the structural funds. And you have Bulgaria, which has no capacity to absorb money. You know, the political parties are fighting who absorb less money, not who absorb more money, which has actually surpluses. So we pay out our debts. We are not getting more debts. And you can easily say, well, if we believe that it's all about money, free money from Europe or free money from the markets to finance the deficit, then those southern countries should perform better than Bulgaria. They should perform way better than Bulgaria.
If I can jump in here, this graph really tells you a lot, because by 2007, I think until 2007, Bulgaria didn't actually receive any money from the EU funds. We had pre-accession funds, which helped with some structural reforms, but they weren't, agricultural policy funds, and yeah, you know, the vast part of the money that Bulgaria has so far received from the EU is received after 2011 was actually the first year where we skipped we went above 1 billion euro. And these countries, I mean Portugal, Greece as well, Portugal is actually the leading net beneficiary of all the competitiveness programs, mind you. And they're actually the country which is probably, you know, together with Greece, one of the least competitive nowadays.
Yeah.
Because it's not the question of what amount of EU money you receive, but also what you do with it. And, you know, how it circles inside the economy. What's left after it shows in those GDP numbers and then it leaves the next year, what's actually left in the economy as improved competitiveness.
Yeah, so you see who is beneficiary of free money and who is not, Bulgaria. And we will see in the next graph how are performing these countries. Well, this is a comparison between the EU, which is the 100%, Bulgaria and the Eurozone, which is a little bit above the EU. This is GDP per capita. Usually when economists talk about wealth in one country, it means GDP per capita per person in its purchasing power standard. So what can you buy with this GDP per capita? So if you have less GDP, but also your prices are lower, then you can afford more stuff. And you see that Bulgaria is growing. It starts from 22-23%, and it goes like 42-43%. And you see during the crisis years, we are not falling, but we are like frozen over there. And this is how it changed in other countries. In all these countries that benefited from deficits, from deficits and from cheap money. Greece, Spain, France, Italy, Portugal, all of these countries for these 11 years, and this is like 7 years of boom and low interest rates, they actually declined. They became more poor. Or relatively to the EU, they became poorer. And you see Bulgaria, which is actually growing like almost twice what it has. So I think that this shows a pretty interesting picture for all of those who say, well, competitiveness, structural reform, stuff like this is important, but we should focus on how to ease the markets, to finance deficits, and to absorb more money. This is how the difference between Bulgaria and all of those countries changed. So it's a percentage point of difference. So you see Greece is like 56 percentage points ahead back in 2000, and now it's 33%. Probably in a few years we can level with Greece if the contraction over there continues, and this will be a total shock for all those people who made comments in 2009 and 2010 that there was a problem with Greece, but they are actually doing the right thing, we should follow them. There were such people. There are people who give examples with Cyprus, people who give examples with Greece, people who are even currently giving examples that we should follow Belarus because it's a great social market economy or stuff like this. So something else that you learn is that you, especially for instance from the coverage of Baroness Thatcher death yesterday, that stupid people are everywhere. In England, in Sofia, everywhere. So you should never forget that. And sometimes the rhetoric of stupid people is actually quite strong and can make you angry and can make you think that it's substantial because you hear it all the time, but probably it's not that substantial. This is a comparison between Bulgaria and Italy. Back in 2000, Italy is one of the richest members of the EU. It have GDP per capita and PPS above the average, like 120%. It's close to Germany. So back in 2000, Italy and Germany are level. 11 years later, Italy is not doing any reforms. We have a famous guy ruling over there, owner of a football club. So they are more focused on football. They win the World Cup, I think, at this point. And they are doing no reforms. If you look at any international indexes, like competitiveness index or economic freedom index, you see that Italy is not improving, it's actually going down for these 11 years. And what you see is that GDP per capita is also going down as a comparison to other countries, not in absolute terms. And it's actually the average European level. So if you say, our goal is to have the average wealth of the EU, you can remove that and say our goal is to have the income and the wealth of Italy, which was not possible to be said back in 2000. And you see Bulgaria, which is growing, and actually the difference between Bulgaria and Italy back in 2000 was more than four times. So the average Italian was more than 4 times richer than the average Bulgarian. Then we have 11 years of structural reforms in Bulgaria. I wanted to see more, but still there was reforms in Bulgaria. You have 11 years wasted time for Italy. And what happened is that the average Italian now is twice as rich as Bulgarian. Well, you can say this is bad, this is awful. He is still twice as rich. Yes, that's true. That's why there is anger in Bulgaria. That's why people are on the streets because of the electricity bills. But still, half of the part is being taken. It's not something that you can change in 10 years, probably not in generation. So again, what are the crisis challenges in Europe? The key difference. Everybody see that Europe needs growth, but it needs it for different reasons. Some countries in Europe, most of the rich countries, those southern countries, they need growth to keep their standard of living and to finance their expenses. Competitiveness in that case is not a must, one might say. So in other terms, people in Italy or in Spain or in Greece, what they are saying is we're actually living well. We have a few nice years. We want to keep that. So doing reforms is tough. If you can somehow ease the pressure on us, make euro bonds, or somehow give confidence to markets, or change the policy of the ECB, not only to follow inflation, to focus on inflation, but also on jobs. If you don't have enough jobs, let them print money. So the idea is we don't want to change anything. We actually like how we live. So if you can ease the pressure on us, we are fine with that. How you do it, it's your problem, it's Germany's problem or something like this. And there are other countries who actually need growth actually to achieve something, which is to reduce absolute poverty. And this is definitely Bulgaria. So this is a completely different challenge. It's a country that wants to keep it as it is, because the alternative is to go bankrupt or to become poor. And there is a country that hates the status quo and wants to grow. And you see that you need different policies to achieve those things, or at least the motivation is different. And note the difference between Greece these days and Bulgaria back in 96 or 97 or even back in the 90s. Both countries in trouble due to bad policies, nobody will dispute that, and corrupt politicians also, nobody will dispute that. What is the difference is that Bulgarians, they wanted change. They were poor, there was hyperinflation, they wanted something to change. They were ready to vote a new parliament and to accept any reforms. While people in Greece, they don't want to change. This is the big difference, because those countries face the same challenge of failed states, but in one of the countries people want to change, and in the other country people don't want to change. They want somehow to be saved by whatever policy, but they actually want to keep what they have, to keep their jobs and their benefits and everything. And this is not a blame. I want to make sure, because somebody can be offended or something. This is not a blame to the Greek people. If I was there, I would want the same thing probably. It is perfectly rational. If you had something, it was promised by you, by the EU leaders, it was promised by your politicians, it was secured in all EU documents that if something happened, they'll bail you out or something like this. So it's perfectly rational to want it. What I'm saying here is that there is a great social challenge. You need a change to happen, and people don't want that change. And it's completely different than Bulgaria when you need a change to happen in 97, and people agree that there is a need for change. Last slide before I give the word to Javor. What is the challenge of Bulgarian growth, the perspective, and the EU? I can easily separate between those two. The first is that we are benefiting from the single market. It actually promotes growth. So EU is the main source of investments, that's clear. Also through credit, most of the investments in Bulgaria are EU banks giving money to Bulgaria banks, and those money go to Bulgaria businesses. So it's way of investment, but it's not a direct investment like building factory. It goes through to the finance system. Also, EU is our main trading partner. Still, our exports prove to be flexible with the problems, the recession now that is, I don't know if it's officially recession, probably not, but it is. In Europe, our goods actually succeeded to change their direction. If there is not enough consumption in Italy, they go to China or whatever. So we prove that we have competitive companies, but not enough to create the jobs that we want. And also EU gives opportunities to people, which is to go to other countries to work, to find better education, to travel and all of these. These are things that I think is indisputable. This is the leading motivation and it's still the case. What is hampering our growth is the centralization of the decision making in Europe, which is bureaucracy and all kinds of standards. This means high cost for businesses, in many cases less competition. If you make it more costly for a business to enter a market, you have less competition. And also the competitive policies in Europe are not welcomed. As I said, different challenges obviously need different solutions, but such kind of approach in Europe is not welcome. You see it in the tax debates, tax harmonization debate, tax competition debate. You see it in Europe 2020 or stuff like this. And last, you have, as I said, rich countries, one-size-fits-all policies, which are totally inadequate for Bulgaria. One of those policies is the tax harmonization debate or the tax policies which are proposed for Bulgaria, which is you need to tax wealth. This is corporate profits and incomes. Well, the difference is that in places like France or Germany, you have wealthy people, you have employment, you have people who generate incomes, and you have lots of capital generated for millennia. So it's easier to tax that. There are people who can actually, that you can tax their incomes, and there are lots of capital, and if you tax capital, you can actually fill up the budget. Well, in Bulgaria, it's a completely different story. We don't have enough capital, we don't have enough profits, we don't have actually enough companies that operate. We have like the lowest employment in Europe, and we have low salaries. It's impossible to fill up the budget taxing corporate profits and income in Bulgaria. It's inadequate for Bulgaria. If we became rich in 20 years, probably we'll do that. What we are doing is we are saying, well, nobody is working, there is no profits, let's tax consumption. At least nobody can escape consumption. Somehow they will consume and we will tax that. So that's what generating money in Bulgaria. It's excise duties, it's VAT. It's not the flat tax is like the biggest issue for the election. It generates like 10% of the budget and 4% of the GDP. And historically, it never generated more. So you can imagine like the most challenging debate is about 10% of the budget when we actually filling the budget with VAT. The green economy, all this carbon trade or green energy that I mentioned earlier, I think it's also hampering our growth. You see it, what happened as a social pressure on the streets. For me, it's obvious that 20 years from now we'll have green energy. It's just a question of should we transfer money by force from other sectors to green energy so we have it earlier. Like, should we pay 500 leva this year because we want it this year, or should we pay 5 times less in 2 years from now? This is the whole debate. All the investments and all the innovations will be made with or without us. Germany will probably invest in this and all the other countries will do it. It's a price that we pay just to have the same policy as the rich countries. And subsidizing agriculture, we can talk about that, but again, it is a policy that I think is hampering for us. First, because we are receiving less money than the folks in France, for instance, or in Italy. And secondly, because you see how these subsidies are actually going through the system, they are inflating the price of land. It's much more expensive if you want to have agricultural land to manufacture on it or to have any other kind of investments that need, again, in agriculture, like fruits and stuff like this, that need less land, because this type of policy actually makes you do certain investments in crops and stuff like this, which will receive more money. So I'll give the word to Yavor to say about the Eurozone, which is the other big challenge.
Okay, if it's okay, I'm going to stand up. So I'm not going to follow exactly what is written here. You can see it for yourself. Because while I was listening to Peter, some other things came up to my mind, so I would rather address those. And really, if you think about it, at the current moment, the main question in front of Bulgaria and its EU membership, its EU future, is whether or not we should actually enter into the Eurozone. This is the key issue because as all countries that eventually are accepted in the EU are expected to at some time join the currency union as well. There are no time limits. Nobody's going to tell you have to come this year or come next year. There are some certain technical criteria that you have to cover. Once you do that, you're welcome to join. But Bulgaria, the previous government, as well as the next government probably, and as well as the governments of Poland, Romania, and many other countries, part of which actually cover these criteria, decided to suspend their membership for now. And it's kind of weird because while in Poland there are some Eurosceptics in the parliament, you could call them Eurosceptics, people who don't like Europe that much. Our previous prime minister and our previous cabinet was actually, it came to power as probably the most Euro-optimistic government that we've had so far. And they wanted to get us into the Eurozone by 2011, if I'm not mistaken, or 2012. So this was their goal, this is what they ran on. We're going to go as fast as we can and into the Eurozone. And now all of a sudden all of these countries are backing out. And you have to ask yourself, why is this happening? And this is happening because the rules of the game have really changed in these last few years. The Eurozone, as it stands currently, has nothing to do, absolutely nothing to do, as far as structural mechanisms, purpose, to do with what it was. Only the members are the same for now. And it's not because new members are joining in as well. So what actually happened is that it was believed that entering the Eurozone is free. If you think about it, we are kind of in the Eurozone already, because Bulgaria's left, our national currency, is tied to the euro. It's not tied directly to the euro, mind you, it's tied to the German mark. This is what our currency board is to. It's to the German mark, and through the German mark, it's tied to the euro. So, theoretically, if the euro fails and Germany leaves, you're tied to the Germany, not to the euro. So our currency will still have some value. This is something that you might not know. But it was considered free, and currently we have two levels for each euro. The course of our currency, its value actually follows the value of the euro. So we are pretty much, you could say, members of the Eurozone. What has changed is what Peter mentioned, all these financial mechanisms that were put in place in order to save countries like Greece, like Portugal, like Spain, countries who spent too much, way too fast, and when their bills started coming home, when their chickens came home to roost, they had no actual money that they can use to cover their debt repayments. That's why, in order to save the Eurozone, the other countries had to pile all this money and then start giving it away to other countries, and but in this process, creating these mechanisms. But what is the problem for Bulgaria? Eurobonds, this is the same thing. So the ESM, the Financial European Stability Mechanism, and the EFSF before that, they are actually steps towards Eurobonds. Once you have all the Eurobonds stuff in place, these things might as well go away because you won't need transfers because everyone is going to get their debt from one and the same place. Because you're not going to be able to go and buy Greek debt. For example, you can buy your debt, and that's it. And then they should put it around. Okay, next slide. What you see in the last two slides is what Bulgaria will actually have to pay if it enters the Eurozone now as commitments to the European Stability Mechanism. And as you can see, it's a kind of strange formula. It's calculated by using the population and the overall GDP, and then you put them together and you come up with a number. This number, you use it, you apply it to the 700 billion that they want together, and you see what each country has to pay. This is what Bulgaria will actually have to pay. 6.5% of GDP, of our GDP, which is, you could say, quite a considerable amount. So if we enter in the Eurozone tomorrow, we have to be able to provide this if it's called for. What does this mean? The ESM has core capital, which is capital that's being paid in. Okay, so when they put this thing together, they said, Germany said. Okay, guys, each of you is giving me, you give me 2 billion, you give me 3 billion, you give me 6 billion, we put them here, we have 80 billion. But if I need 30 billion more, you have to give them to me, or you have to give them to me. So everyone knows what he has to pay. The problem is that one by one, throughout the debt crisis, countries started falling off the grid. So we don't have 27 countries paying into this. We have a couple of countries taking money out of this thing and expecting to receive money out of this thing, as far as Spain is concerned, at least. But we don't have 20 countries giving money, because these countries went from the giving end to the receiving end. And these are countries like, you know, almost Spain and Greece and Portugal, but we also have Italy here. Italy is on the brink, France probably as well. But if Italy goes on the other side, and if any of these other countries, when they go to the other side, its share is distributed equally among the other remaining countries. So you see that this 6.5% of GDP, actually, if, for example, Italy leaves and a couple of other countries, this might as well go to 13% of GDP. These are not money that we have to give at hand, but these are money that if Brussels calls us and tells us, you have to give us this money, we have to give them. We have no such money. Our fiscal reserve can't cover even the first payment problem. You know, what's left of it is buffer payments. Okay, next slide. So what you see is that it can actually go even bigger afterwards, after the first 10-12 years have passed. You have to give even more money to this fund if it still exists, you know. So this is something that you can take away from this presentation as what the Bulgarian finance minister, Simeon Dianko, the ex-finance minister, when he said, we are not going to enter the Eurozone at this time. I believe this was at a lecture at Princeton 2 days before he was fired. he was fired, he found out that he was fired when he landed here. So. This is why he said this, because there are too many commitments now. This is not the same thing. Why do Bulgarians have to pay for the debt of Italians, for example? Italians have spent all where they had. They have 100,000%, 120% debt to GDP. They live way better than us here. And at the end of the day, if we actually come into the Eurozone, we will be expected to provide money to the Italians so that they can service their debt. And that's the one big issue. The other big issue is that Eurozone countries have recently started introducing things such as the financial transaction tax, and they are pushing towards tax harmonization. These are things that take place within the Eurozone. You know, other EU members, they can join or they can opt out of such agreements. Most of them decide to opt out at the moment. As far as the FTT is concerned, it was only introduced in 11 countries. That's it. 11 out of 27, it was actually promoted as a great success, and some of them have not even officially introduced it yet. It's going to kick in a year or two. So what you have to see is that this push for more one-size-fits-all policies is not good for countries such as Bulgaria, Romania, even Greece for that matter, or the other southern countries. Why? People say, well, in order to have, you know, you have to tax the rich. We don't have rich people here. We have, you know, probably 5,000 or 10,000 rich guys, half of them criminals or something, you know, but we don't have rich, working, middle class that you can tax out of its, you know, earnings so that you can redistribute.
Yeah, it's not because of salary. There is no salary to tax.
Yeah, there is no salary to tax. And So when you say, well, we have to come up with a common tax policies, you know what this means? This means French tax policies in this regard. So this means higher taxes. And they say that by doing so, by equalizing the tax base, this will spur competitiveness. They do this all the time. Keep this in mind. What does harmonizing anything has to do with competitiveness? I mean, this is totally—it's the other way around. You know, we need low taxes so that we can attract more capital, so that we can grow faster, so that we can actually, you know, catch up to the other guys. The other guys, like, you, as you can see, many of them are going down as far as GDP, purchasing power, standards are concerned. That's because they raise their taxes. Capital flees from there, comes here, goes to other places. Their wages go down relative to ours. This means that ours grow faster than theirs because we can attract more capital. That's what we need to do. And now what the Eurozone is trying to do is kind of consolidate this effort, which I don't think goes well with the cohesion policy. So there is a, you know, collusion there of principles. I don't know if... Yeah, well, so all in all, this is a really big question of whether Bulgaria should join the EU or not. And if not, at the moment we seem to be playing the let's wait and see. We kind of play that and see what happens. When they call, we're like, oh yeah, we have an internal crisis now. You know, we'll get back to you on that EU stuff. And we don't actually see, we're not going in any direction. We're not saying, no, we're not going to accept the euro. We're not saying, yes, we're going to accept the euro once we cover the criteria. Actually, it's my personal belief that it was last year or the year before that our finance minister on purpose, you know, violated some of the criteria so that, you know, Brussels doesn't go and say, hey, come on, you can join now, you know, because there is too much tension, there are too many questions that haven't been answered yet, and that have to be answered before a country like Bulgaria joins the euro. And this is the biggest cost-benefit analysis of our future EU membership, is whether or not we should join the euro. And if not, what to do with the currency board? This is, you know, a bigger topic at this point. So with this, I believe this is the last slide.
Just something to mention.
Okay, this can stay as a... when we talk about the EU policy and why there are people which are nervous in the way it happens and why there is this disconnect between the EU bureaucrats or the EU aristocracy and the people on the street, there is something that you should always remember. For instance, when somebody said, okay, let's make a step toward tax harmonization, but just with the tax base for corporate profits, for instance, tax base. And some totally not influential guy somewhere in the European Commission or in the Parliament, in the European Parliament says, well, why not harmonize the whole tax system or the whole pension system and have them all the same? And then people like me are getting really nervous. And somebody might say, well, why are you nervous? It's just some regular guy. There are all kinds of ideas and talks, like in every parliament. There was no need to be nervous. It's just a small step. It's just about the tax base. Well, the reason is the way that EU is making its decision. It is pushing in a direction. It is a direction of centralization, obviously. And every once in a while, something happens. They make a breakthrough to more harmonization. For instance, the crisis is a great opportunity to do more in that respect. With all this, the Eurobonds talk, with all these fiscal transfers that are official. The trick here is that once you give your yes to a certain European policy, then it's all gone. You cannot change it. For instance, if we say yes to the economic coordination and corporate tax base policy, once we say yes, our parliament says yes, we cannot escape. In order to escape, we need 27 other yeses to let us escape. So, imagine, like, for instance, every day somebody is telling you, well, come in this library to see some book. And for instance, you don't want to come here, you have something better to do. But imagine that even once, if you let yourself to be cheated to come in this library, you can never leave. And this makes you nervous when you take this decision, because when you take the decision, it's forever. Or at least you can somehow make the arguments with all the 27 others and then do it like the general policy, which will never happen, especially with the tax harmonization, because France will love it. So this is why such kind of policy making is a nervous one, because Bulgarian parliament can make all kinds of mistakes, but you go on the streets, throw some rocks, and it's gone. You have other parliament, you can change the constitution even. But in Europe, you cannot change anything. Once you accept it, it's forever, unless you take the crucial step of going out of the EU, which will have totally negative effects on investments, on trade, on geopolitical scale and everything. So this is the real challenge, how you make policy when there is no step back. You can only walk forward. So, yeah. Well, sorry that we talked so long. I think that it's more than
Q&A,
yeah.
No, next one.
So you have any questions, comments?
Okay, so I have a question, but I don't know how suitable it is for this topic specifically. Do you think that the UK will eventually find a loophole to avoid the freedom of movement policy for Bulgaria and Romania till the end of the year? Or do you think that they will eventually leave the EU at some point?
No, I don't think that they will find any way. Usually when we have a debate about Europe and a big decision and reactions, I usually like the UK reaction. It sounds closer to my thoughts. As I said, they are bound to this policy. Something good that they are doing is that they want to separate free movement of people and social policies within the UK. And this is something that should happen in every policy. I am perfectly okay of going to the UK or to France or French people coming to Bulgaria or whatever, but I don't think that with going to other country, I'm in the next minute entitled to free healthcare or free education or whatever. I mean, it's policies that they have for their society. Usually it takes some time before you became a full member of society, like it's the same in all countries. And this was a great problem, how you make free movement of people, but don't have the free riding of just poor people going to countries where they can have free stuff. But this also shows you that even that the EU is like 60 years old and all this talk about Europeans and free movement and everything, there is still tension. There are still people who don't like the idea that Bulgarians and Romanians will go to the UK. Again, as I said earlier, some of those people are probably just stupid, and they are those who are in the media. And I can surely say that there was a media, one of the famous media in UK, that in 2007 paid Bulgarian poor people to go on the first day to the Heathrow just to take a picture of them. And they didn't go, by the way. They took the money and didn't go. So it was a classic Bulgarian trick. They say, okay, we'll do it. They took the money and they didn't go. So again, the rhetoric is stronger than the actual tensions. But I don't think that they'll find any way to avoid that. I'm not sure that they'll make a referendum in 2017. It's a quite big step, and it probably depends on what happens with the euro. We have 5 members out of 17 being saved, so obviously
six.
Yeah, and probably Slovenia soon. So yeah, they're growing.
Yeah, yes, Slovenia also.
It will be interesting if all the members are being saved at the end.
I think this whole thing has been artificially ballooned at the moment. Mainly through the United Kingdom Independence Party, which I also like on some thoughts. But as far as their UK policy is concerned, I think they're using the moment so that they can raise it further in the polls, and they're spreading panic around and making this a bigger topic than it actually is, although I agree with you that these two things should be separated.
yeah. Free movement and taking first step. It has nothing to do one with the other.
But also important is that when you have such kind of problems, such kind of parties, which like the leader is taking the word in the European Parliament, is in giving a headache to Barroso or all the other members, so they win support. They win support for all the people who actually like the single market, but don't like the European bureaucrats. But such kinds of parties are actually against the single market.
Yep.
So this is a problem. I mean, the only voices which are trying to break the ice or the European usual talk are voices which are not wise or sound. And this is a problem because they can attract more people than they probably deserve.
Okay. I'll start talking now about countries who aim to join actually the European Union, not to join the Eurozone. Primarily Serbia, Macedonia, then Montenegro, Albania, etc., etc. You've seen that these countries are accepting a lot of conditions that EU sets in front of them. Blindly will take it, pass through Parliament like 50 or so laws in one day and not even read them. Just translate them because Croatian, Serbian, Bosnian, Montenegro are similar. Just copy paste and that's it. We suggest to these countries rather to step down a bit and shape up before rushing to EU rather than to continue their policies that they are taking now.
Well, to be honest, I do think that the best thing to do is to actually join. And actually some of the copy-paste may be useful because you should make a comparison between what is the EU proposing and how it's happening and the alternative. And the alternative is not the ideal, because everyone will choose the ideal, but the alternative can be more problematic. And it's true that once you are within the EU, you are at least part of the club. All the free movement and the single market are working for you. You can probably stronger your institutions, like in Bulgaria. This is a big positive for the EU that there is actually someone saying, well, what's happening with the justice in your country? I mean, there is no justice. You should do something. And this is a good thing that there is somebody from outside who is respected and the media will take the statement and put it everywhere, who is saying, well, there is a problem with your with the justice in your country. You need better laws. You need law enforcement, rule of law. And so these kinds of things are positive. Also, some of the... this is the tricky. What happens if the one-size-fits-all policy, which is not made by your parliament, but as you said, by the Europe, and you're just copy-pasting, is working actually for you? In the short term, this is good. In the long term, some other things that are not working for you may also come. For instance, some of the rules which are out of the single market, they are just regulations, are good. For instance, the regulation that the state cannot give money to failed companies, failed state companies. For instance, we cannot give money to our railway. It's forbidden by EU. So we should say, well, you need to make reforms. You need to, if there are people who are not doing anything there, you should fire them, replace them with people which can do more work. So this is given actually pressure to do reforms. Also, if the EU is saying, well, we look at the rules for the attorneys in your country or the accountants. Well, it doesn't seem to have much competition. You have all the stupid requirements that he practiced 10 years before he can practice for the first year, which is kind of strange, or he have this license and this like... So again, it's a policy which is saying, well, you're doing something stupid. The EU rules are trying to prevent that, so please free up the so-called free professions, which are actually regulated professions. So some of the copy-paste actually can be useful. And for the country and all the Balkans countries are countries with weak institutions, this is something that's hugely important, and probably within the EU these institutions can become stronger.
What makes you think that this is going to be the French tax that is going to be harmonized around? And if it is, why would you need 27 yeses or noes? Because unless they change the article of the treaty this morning, you need unanimity. So if Bulgaria says no, that's enough. So it's up to the Bulgarian government to decide whether yes or no. What makes you think that if you meet the criteria for Europe, the next day or overnight, Brussels is going to be at the doorstep in Sofia, dragging Bulgaria in desperately, because without Bulgarian contribution, the EMS is not going to function. Certainly, if you're going to use Margaret Thatcher, she deserves to be looked at in a more than one-dimensional proposition. She was the only British Prime Minister who actually fought a pro-EU membership and a pro-EU referendum. Was she anti-euro? Yes, but I mean, there is a very clear distinction even for Thatcherites as to what is single market and what is the common currency policy. Yeah. If going and having an outside checkup upon other countries in terms of the judicial system, who's doing that? Aren't they the European bureaucrats? And sure, there are a lot of criticism to drag to European bureaucrats, but I mean, who do you propose that is going to do that? And if you're talking about costs of EU membership, what are the costs of non-membership? And you're saying that convergence is problematic and this didn't happen. You have regression results that shows that without it or with it, we have convergence happening across the years or not, or is this in any way changed over the past, I don't know, 10 or 15 years since negotiations started?
Okay, that's a fair question. I'll touch on some of them. First of all, actually, what I said is that the alternative is probably worse. If all the decision about the Bulgarian future and past are on me, I'll choose the EU. I'll probably choose the same thing. So I think that this was, as I said to your question, I think for a country like Bulgaria, we needed the single market. We needed the institutional support. So I'm ready to accept the costs of the stupid bureaucrats. And the stupid rules. I think that the cost-benefit on such scale is positive for Bulgaria. What I'm saying is not that the alternative is better, but that within the alternative, in the reality that we are living in, we can improve. And we can easily improve when we see that the single market is promoting growth and that the regulations are not promoting our growth. It's actually the opposite. So what I'm saying is not leave the euro or something like this. I'm saying that we have our voice within the EU, and we should probably raise it to say something like the UK position. We like the single market. We don't like the rules and all this Euro bureaucracy. It was the Margaret Thatcher position also. Yeah, she was all for the single market. She didn't like the single currency. Let me see if I can. About the tax harmonization, of course, we have the vote. I agree on that, but what I said is that once we vote yes, for instance, we have a new parliament with populists or whoever is in parliament, they vote yes, so we harmonize our tax system. 2 years later, we are not happy with it.
I'm sorry, why would the parliament vote for it?
Because they want it. Why not? We have many.
The decision making over taxation is on consultation, it's on the special legislative procedure, so Parliament has consultation and the Council has unanimity. I mean, even if they vote...
I mean the Bulgarian Parliament. If the Bulgarian Parliament, for instance, 4 years from now, say yes to some proposition of tax harmonization, it's perfectly possible the Parliament can vote anything. They can vote to nationalize private pension accounts, they can vote anything. I'm saying in a... imagine that there is such kind of vote in Bulgaria and our parliament says yes, you can change the article and there will be tax harmonization, we like it. 2 years after that, they change their mind. Or the people change their mind and they say, well, we like the flat tax with 10%, we don't like the 75% tax. Let's change it. Let's go to the parliament and change it. But the parliament, what will they say? Well, we voted it once, there was no more vote. Now we need 27 votes. That's why I say that it's once you do something anonymously, you can, there is no turning back. You need to recollect all the other 27 again. So, yes, we have our vote. If there is a vote coming, we should vote no to such kind of economic coordination or tax harmonization. We did vote no, actually. But if somewhere in the future we say yes to such kind of policy, there is no turning back, even if we change the government.
The Stability and Growth Party, they voted for it. They agreed on it. In 2005, you have two of the biggest countries who don't meet the criteria, so French and Germany, so they agreed to freeze. Did they go back on that?
French and Germany can do whatever they want. I mean, this is not even a question.
Did they go back on that or not? Because apparently we can't go back.
Excuse me?
What did
they passed the Stability and Growth Pact in 1993. This
okay.
is the excessive deficit
okay.
procedure
yeah.
for the breakup
yeah.
of the euro criteria. Yeah?
No one actually.
10 years down the line, because you have some countries that don't meet it, some of the big countries, they decide to freeze it, and then by now we have 6 regulations that are changing what was decided then.
Yeah, that's what the big countries can do.
Yeah, but it's something that nobody followed. They all broke the rules.
Was, you know,
and so why do you mind what the rules are if you don't follow the rules?
Because
if you know that
country.
The rules aren't followed, then why is it a problem?
Because
are?
We can be bullied into following such rules. We have a weak political class, which is, you know, it can be easily influenced. Many of our most, you could say, scandalous and, you know, probably criminal guys that ruled us in the last 10 years are now in the European Parliament. They have lifelong immunity. This is what our political class does. We don't believe in our political class. So the more big decisions it makes, the better it is for us at the moment.
I don't disagree, but membership did not create the Bulgarian political class.
Excuse me?
Membership did not create
no,
the
No, I know,
Bulgarian
but still,
class.
It's a problem for us. That's why it doesn't fit us.
Well, yeah, and the other thing is, one thing is that you have a rule that is not followed by everybody, and by Germany, they were the first one to break it. And the other thing is to have rules that are actually perfect for France or Germany or whatever, are actually imposed on countries like Bulgaria who are doing unfair competition with low taxes. And you see what happened in Cyprus? They had the biggest bank system, if you compare it to GDP. And what did Europe say? Here is the money, we'll save us, we'll save you. And by the way, 10 years from now, your banking system should be the same as ours. You cannot be more competitive than us. And it is written in a document. Your banking system should be on the average level of the EU. You are not approved to do it.
This didn't happen only to Cyprus. It happened to two of the small financial centers. This also happened to Ireland. Where you know, in Ireland, what they did was that what they actually proposed in Cyprus. What was it? Your corporate tax has to go up 15%. You can't have a 10% corporate tax. This is what they said. And I believe Bulgaria, I don't know about Romania, but I believe Bulgaria is probably the only country left with a 10% corporate tax rate. And they view this as unfair competition because Chinese producers of cars that recently opened, for example, here in Bulgaria, they are not going to open in Poland. They're going to open here in Bulgaria because we have lower, you know, taxes, and we need these lower taxes. So what we say is that things should remain the way that countries should be the ones who decide what their own tax level is, because every country has different needs, and every country is works differently. For example, Sweden or Norway can gather 50% of the country's GDP and then distribute it almost perfectly and make the thing work. We can't do this even with Turkey. And we lose half our budget, we don't know what goes where and who got it and what was it spent for and so forth. So our administration and our entire system, it can't actually work in this way. Yeah.
I'm sorry, in which document was it said that you are breaching your competition, the competitiveness?
Document?
Who says, because you say they said, who said?
Okay, Olli Rehn, for instance, you can Google him, I'm sure, yeah,
Sarkozy,
many occasions, Sarkozy as well, Sarkozy all the time, actually. Yeah.
So you should always look not only on the official document,
yeah,
but in the rhetoric. For instance, if there is a rule, a written rule, you cannot drink water in this library, this is one thing. But there can be no rules, but just when you enter the library, a nice lady comes to you and say, well, I don't advise you to drink water. So, you see, it is something like a rule. it gives you a perspective how things are going, but it's not written. So I also have problem, even if it's written, we'll have competition in all areas, and then the French president go to EU summit, and on the doorstep say, I will fight for tax harmonization. Well, I have problem with that. Even if it's not written in the document, at some point it may be written there. So when you look at perspective, you also listen to the rhetorics.
Well, I'll still ask it then. So one of the problems that you indicated was the fragility of the European system. When one of the fragility to the crisis, per se, as it used to be. So one of the solutions that I see to it is a close union in some of the European leaders as well. However, as far as I understand, you're completely, you are opposing the closer European Union fiscal and monetary one. So what I was really not clear on the solutions that you propose alternatives. So instead of getting closer, instead of harmonizing, instead of getting together, so what are the propositions?
We had a lecture last year with a famous economist who was involved in all these talks in Ireland, especially in Greece, in other countries that were negotiating with IMF. And he started his presentation saying, well, basically the things that we said. He said, well, we started to cooperate, like sharing the risk. Countries that were not competitive were giving the chance to borrow at cheap price and stuff like this. So we said such kind of decisions, like solutions that were general for all, bring us to the current crisis. And then he went through the programs and the solution that he gave was, well, we need closer union, like the fiscal union, economic cooperation, stuff like this. And we asked him the question, well, you started by saying that all those steps that were not the single market, but trying to cooperate even on policies, actually bring us to the crisis. And then you say that the solution is more of this. And he was taken aback. He couldn't answer this question. He said, well, yeah, there is such contradiction, but this is what I propose. So if you look in the short term, probably the closer union seems like a solution. Like, well, you have somebody that can pay his bills, you have somebody that's working, let's make the closer union between them, and those people pay their bills. But in the long term, things maybe work differently. Like the single currency, it works perfectly well in the first year. Countries that were not competitive were growing. They have a nice standard of living. But at the end, you see what happens. So I think that the sustainable solution is painful. There is, if you have a problem and the solution is not painful, it's a trick. You should always remember that in life and economics. If you have a problem and somebody offers you a solution which is not painful, he's making a trick on you. So if you have a real solution, it will probably mean to stand on the single market, forget about these other one-size-fits-all policies. If there is a failure of a state that cannot pay its bills, well, he is free to leave. So give failure a chance. Imagine a system when any entrepreneur can fail. This is a fragile system, a system that actually will sum up hidden failures and will make everybody poor off. So if there was something which the nature is saying that he should fail because he is living well and he is earning nothing, let him fail. It's what happened in Bulgaria in 97. And it's good that we failed, because after that we can go out on a sustainable basis.
Just to follow up, so if I understand correctly, so there was a lack of regulation over the like possibilities of failure or debt crisis, and the solution to it to remove all regulation whatsoever and let everybody do whatever they want.
No, it was not a lack of regulation. It was a rhetoric or regulation that was saying that we'll save anybody who have troubles. And there was actually a question to Draghi, the head of the ECB, last week, and they said, do you have plan B if Cyprus decides to leave, or a situation in Italy goes even deeper, or in Spain, and somebody decides to leave, do you have a plan B? He said, no such thing. So the only plan within the EU institution is that it survive as it is. Nobody is supposed to leave the ECB, the single currency. Nobody is supposed to leave Europe. I don't know if there is even a mechanism to do that. So,
but he, Draghi actually said this two times. He repeated it. Mm-hmm. He verbally bolded it. you can see this. This is his last press conference actually.
Yeah. And what I'm saying is that you always have failures. There was other currency areas in the history. They always had failures within them. What I'm saying, should you let somebody to fail, or are you giving him a blank check saying, we'll always save you? Because if I have check, we'll always save you, I work less. Tomorrow I'll stay in Blagoevgrad and have coffee. If I have a check written, we'll always save you if you have shortage of money. Why bother to go tomorrow to work?
I would say that the problem is that Europe tried to do too much too fast. I would say that this is where actually the problem came from. Europe didn't take its time sticking to the three core principles, the free movement of capital, of people. It didn't actually do this for long enough time so that its member states can actually reach this type of convergence that can probably someday carry them forward as a single body. Europe is currently not a single body. We've got 21 languages. 21 or 23? No? 21 languages, let's say, in the European Union. Different cultures. And, you know, there is a lot of historical tension and hatred between some peoples, even to this day. And this is something that you can't overcome over 15 years, no matter how many stars you put on your flag. No matter how good the idea sounds, when you reach a crisis, people go protest in front of their own parliament. Because this is what they know, you know. They think these are the guys that we elect, these are the guys who take the decisions. So there is a crisis in the EU, you can't go and protest in Brussels. I go and protest in Sofia, for example. What do? We bring down the government. What happens then? Some other people, political figures, see that there are a lot of people who desire change. And they call themselves Eurosceptic. Well, they're probably more, you could describe them as socialist, let's say, and populist is what you call them in Greece. You see what happens in Greece, you know, for example. And they get the votes. And this is bad for the EU itself, because now we have a couple of countries like the Alternative für Deutschland, in Greece and also in Finland, the True Finns. So these are really strong Eurosceptic parties that would take the country out of the Eurozone or the Europe, because Europe kind of tried to go too far and it went into people's, you know, kind of their daily lives and homes. For example, how many of you eat eggs here? Come on, egg eaters, yeah. Okay, so have you noticed any change in the eggs, in their taste the last 6 or 7 months?
Chickens are happy.
No, you haven't noticed that, come on. Yeah, does it taste differently?
No.
Do you think they are happy? You know what the difference is? Do you know what the actual happy chicken means? It doesn't live in this cage, it lives in this cage. Yeah. But in order to comply with this EU standard, all people in Bulgaria who are looking after chickens had to throw their old cages away and buy new cages. Now, this is something that can make you kind of Eurosceptic if you're living in a country that doesn't actually, you know, you don't have as much clients, you don't have that much of a turnover, so this is a problem for you. At some point, the EU tried to do so much things at the same time. It went too far. Who cares if chickens are happy? You can say, chickens are happy if they comply with this criteria, this, this, this. And then you put a stamp, these are happy chickens. Then leave the miserable chickens to the miserable people, you know. If I want to buy excellent happy chickens, I should have the opportunity to do so. I can say, oh, the EU says these chickens are happy, so they're twice expensive. But I might as well enjoy them, you know. and don't mind if I do, and leave the poor guy a chance and the poor businessman a chance. At time, he'll see that there's more money in this happy chicken stuff because people pay more money for them, so he'll try to invest in his own cages, make his own happy chicken and chickens, you know, and get some money out of it. But the EU tried to go too far, too deep, too down, too fast. And at some point, when the crisis hit, people started questioning this stuff. And the lack of response from European institutions, I don't mean the usual thing of, oh, we'll stick together, and I mean the real policies, like, is there a problem here? Did we go too far? They never asked this question. They didn't do this. And, you know, this kind of fueled this entire Eurosceptic wave. And I'm not talking, we're not Eurosceptics, we're Eurorealists. We are maybe Eurozone skeptics, but we're not Eurosceptics. But this entire wave is something that's, you know, it's too dangerous. And maybe the question is it too late for Europe to back off and stick back to its core principles? I believe this is the way forward.
Yep.
Okay, sir, we're short on time, and unfortunately we cannot allow any more questions right now, but we're happy to call you in front and to enjoy a glass of wine, and we'll continue with discussion. Thank you very much. We'll give a round of applause for that.
This program is brought to you by AUBG Talks. For more, please visit us at aubg.bg/talks.